All right. Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming here to listen to my presentation and listen to me talk about myself and TABC and how I got here. So just a quick introduction about myself. My name is Nicole Langley. I'm a major over the Arlington, North Texas region of TABC, Texas Alcoholic Beverage Commission. And I'm very excited to be here to talk with you. I'm very passionate about criminal justice, and I'm very blessed that I came into this field and have gotten to the position where I am. So I'm very enthusiastic to talk about this, and I hope that by the time you're done, you will want this as a career path potentially, or something in law enforcement. I understand that you're in a criminal justice program now, and yes, that's awesome. You're already a step ahead of myself, because I didn't start out in criminal justice. I wanted to be an archaeologist. And then you find out that there's not a lot of call for that. So I went to Baylor University to get my undergraduate degree. And during the course of that time, I milled about, tried to find out where my calling was, and ended up in psychology. So here I am, bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, graduating from college, ready to get a good job. And I find out a psychology degree will get you about $17 an hour, no benefits, no retirement. So it's like, well, what am I going to do now? As a caseworker, it was an extremely lucrative future with part-time caseworking, and if you don't go further. So I looked around, and I found law enforcement. Many of the law enforcement agencies, like the local PDs, they want you to climb about a 6-foot wall. Well, that wasn't going to happen for me. I wasn't going to get over the wall. So I looked around. I looked at different law enforcement options, and I found TABC. And I said, what is this? You know, I'm already a caseworker. I'm already working with juvenile delinquents, age 17, you know, 13 to 17. What can TABC offer for me? You always hear the stories, TABC, you're going to go run, chase the minors in the fields, write the MIPs. But we have merged and morphed into such a different agency over the last 16 years that I've been employed with TABC. So anyway, I get my psychology degree, work as a case manager. I stumble upon TABC and I said, hey, this is great. This is a great law enforcement agency. Let me apply, go through the process. I was fortunate enough, TABC actually put me through the police academy. They paid salary for me as well as putting me through law enforcement academy for the 6 months, which was a fantastic opportunity. I started as an agent, probationary agent, down in Beaumont, Texas. And it was still kind of a little bit of the Wild West in 2007 when I hired. A little bit different down there. Little rural community. They were still chasing the miners through the fields and down through the rivers. But again, over the last 16 years, we've changed. TABC has become a professional agency in law enforcement where we investigate so much more than miners. We look at human trafficking. We look at narcotics violations. We still have the minors in connection to the licensed premises because that's what TABC does, is we regulate the industry. So we still have that avenue, but it's in a larger capacity. We're no longer just following the Class C misdemeanors on the minors. We're also looking at the nexus to the licensed locations, the industry. We're trying to keep them safe, keep them in compliance with the laws of Texas, and make sure that the children that go there, that everyone's safe, right? That's the whole point of what we do. So I worked as an agent in Beaumont for about 6 years, and I decided this is fun. I love working nights and weekends, you know. This is a great, great job. I love going to do operations because there were quite a few undercover operations that we would do with TABC. We'd go in undercover to a bar. We would try to observe and see if a minor would be sold, an intoxicated person would be sold, buy narcotics, see if we can make a nexus to the bar. So quite a few fun things, you know. Got to write the search warrants, got to put people in jail. It was good times. But then after about 6 years, I said, well, let me see. Where do I want my career trajectory to go here with TABC? What do I want? So that's when I found Sam Houston University, and I linked in to the Masters of Public Administration program that's online because I'm a full-time worker. So I was able to do part-time to get my MPA through Sam Houston, which was amazing. So I went from a Baylor Bear to a Bearcat. So still same deal. So I was really blessed for that opportunity to have that. And with that, I was able to apply for promotions. I worked my way up from an agent to the position of sergeant, where I managed a team of about 8 people. And we would still do those operations, but I was their direct oversight. And then I worked my way up to lieutenant, where I had a team of 2 sergeants, and then the agents, and then now I've worked my way up to major. So I have about 36 people working for me, and the whole North Texas region. And what I have found, the higher I go, the more change I can affect in the agency, the better environment I can make for my people and support them so they can go do the mission and feel strong that I have their support. Yeah, I have their back. So it's been amazing, amazing journey. You know, the benefits have been great. When I retire at 50 one day, I will have an amazing retirement package from the state. It's just been a beautiful career path for me. So I wanted to share that with you all. Whatever your journey or course is, it's a great avenue to go. So then I'm going to talk a little bit about TABC and actually give you the history of TABC. It used to be the LCB, the Liquor Control Board. That's what we used to call ourselves. We are a state agency. We are on the same scale as DPS, so we're Schedule C pay, just like DPS, just like the troopers. But what I like to say for my recruitment speech is we're not out there on the roads, we're not tied to the radios, and we're not usually working Christmas. So a lot of benefits to being in TABC and the agency. The duties of the commission include regulating sales, taxation, importation, manufacturing, transporting, and advertising of alcoholic beverages. If you are thinking of a career, there are so many different paths that TABC offers. We have an auditing division. They do several excise tax audits. They look to see and make sure people are reporting the taxes to Texas like they should for all their liquor purchases. We have what's called ports of entry around the borders. They make sure, like during Pisano, during main seasons, people are safe, they're coming over and they're reporting what they're bringing, because there is a limit to what you can bring. And we also have licensing. We have a whole division just built on putting people into business, helping them get processed, helping them get application, because in Texas, you have to have a permit to sell alcohol. It is a privilege in the state of Texas. So a whole division is designed just to help people facilitate that and get into business. TABC mission, again, it's all about the public, right? It's about the people of Texas that we serve and the public we want to protect. That's why we're here. That's what we do. Safety through consistent, fair, and timely administration of the Alcoholic Beverage Code. Service areas. So there are five main regions. Just like DPS, we divide out the state of Texas into five regions. You have region 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. You are actually in region 3, which is the Houston region. My region covers from Wichita Falls to Corsicana and Ennis, that area up there in North Texas. So I'm the major of a region 2. Major for region 3 wasn't able to come today. So I'm glad to be here. That's the breakdown. Very similar, like I said, to other state agencies, how we district ourselves out. So the enforcement division, that's the part that I'm in. We enforce the Alcoholic Beverage Code, Penal Code, and any other applicable statuses. We conduct searches, seizures. We assist other law enforcement agencies. We assist the comptroller quite a bit. You know, they're an amazing state agency because they can go in there, and if you're delinquent in your taxes, they can seize your entire building. They can put a lock on the door and say, until you pay your taxes, all of this inventory, all this alcohol is ours. And if you don't pay it by this amount of time, then we're going to auction it off and take the revenue. So we will assist the comptroller as well if it's a licensed place and they need enforcement assistance. May handle or assist in processing applications if it comes up. But the day-to-day is what the agents do, right? My people on the ground, that they're what make us. They're out there. They're doing priority inspections. They're doing undercover operations. They're doing underage compliance operations. If you, I don't know if anyone's ever done that, but under 18, valid ID, we utilize people to go in and try to purchase alcohol from licensed locations. And they either sell or they don't sell. There's no entrapment there. We don't encourage them. We want them to not sell. That's the goal, right? We want them to be in compliance. So we use people that purposely look young. We tell them, wear your high school shirts. Don't lie. Don't misrepresent your age. And if the location sells to them, then that's on them. And then there's administrative and criminal sanctions that follow that. And that's also part of what makes TABC so unique, is we have the potential for administrative action that we can take. You know, what we found is, as we've evolved as an agency, is we went from filing these Class C misdemeanors on kids that are buying the alcohol to looking at the bigger picture. We're looking at the retailers who sold them the alcohol, and we're filing Class A misdemeanors on the employees that are working and selling these kids alcohol, and we're filing administrative sanctions on the location so that, hey, if you're not operating within the context of the law, then there's going to be a fine. First time sale to minor at a business can be up to $3,000. So again, those things can add up, and we hope that it'll make people compliant and more ensure more that they want to have those policies and procedures in place to keep the kid keep the employees doing what they're supposed to do. Right? They need to be present and checked in. So that's the goal. We also have what's called the Trace Division within TABC. Fantastic division we started about 3 years ago. And so if there's a fatality accident or serious bodily injury, we turn around and trace the source of the alcohol back to a licensed premise if it was one. So back when I was an agent down in Orange, we had a couple of kids. They went and got, you know, alcohol during homecoming weekend. They go and get in a fatality accident, okay? Two of them died, one of them critically injured. I traced the source of that alcohol back to a licensed premise, and we were able to file on that premise and the employee that sold. And the Trace Division has evolved into a division within TABC that only specializes in that. So they're able to be very quick in response, get those warrants, get the video, get the evidence they need to within, you know, 48 hours and move forward. Agents conduct undercover operations, underage compliance operations. I mentioned that. We try to be proactive. Spring break is coming up. Please be safe. Be conscientious. Get a ride home. Those are the messages that we put out on our Facebook, our Twitter. That's the message we push to our retailers. And we tell them, too, hey, we're going to be checking. We're going to be doing those underage compliance operations. We're going to make sure that you are being safe and responsible with the service of alcohol. One of the things I like to say when I teach basic peace officer academies is this is a legalized drug, right? Alcohol. It changes the way your body acts, your mental acuity, everything is changed by alcohol. It influences you. So it's legalized drug. It has to be regulated. And that's where TABC comes in. Again, some of the investigations that we do, alcohol sales to intoxicated persons, to minors, breaches of the peace. If a fight happens on a licensed premise, it has to be reported to TABC, or there's a potential for a sanction against the location. Prohibited hours. My gosh, you guys are close to Houston. I was a sergeant in Houston for about a year and a half, and we were up till dawn just about every night because the prohibited hours ran rampant. People wanted to sell 3-4 o'clock in the morning, and we're like, you know, we have these laws. You have to get home. You have to stop the sale. So it was nonstop. Dallas is much the same. I like to say Dallas is like a smaller Houston. You can go anywhere and find illegal alcohol sales at 4 a.m, unfortunately. So my agents continue to work that and try to get people in compliance. Narcotics trafficking, you know, we've learned that bars have a huge nexus to human trafficking and narcotics. It's an avenue for people to have the sales, launder the money, hide where they're coming from. It's a huge issue. So we have agents that are full-time undercover that go in and try to buy those narcotics. And then we cancel location if they're repetitive offenders. We cancel and we take their permit, and sometimes they even go on a list where they can't have a permit for a year or longer. Illegal weapons. Again, it's kind of back to the old Al Capone bootlegging days, right? Alcohol, guns, drugs, women. There can be a whole combo there that you find being illegally operated at licensed locations. So we're always very cognizant of what's going on. Bootlegging, fraud, money laundering. One thing when I was working in Beaumont, we had Hardin County. So you'd have like Lumberton, Silsbee, these areas over there. And in the rural areas, you would find a lot of people bootlegging. Like they're over there with a still. And in the state of Texas, it's illegal to even own a still and, of course, operate it as well. But you can't even be in a possession of a still. So we would find people many times brewing their own mash and making their own, you know, whiskey. I'm like, why would you do that? Why? Because it could be this antifreeze combination that'll kill you. Why not just go to Specs and buy it? But you'll find people doing it, especially when that show, was it Moonshiners, came out. We saw an influx of people wanting to be experimental and try to make their own. So, again, even the mere possession of still is illegal in Texas. So what to expect? If you or you know someone that you think you want to encourage to become a TABC employee, whether it's an auditor, an agent, a licensing specialist, lots of different paths. For enforcement, there is an academy if you apply. So I'll kind of go over that avenue. There's intensive training that we do. We focus on the alcohol beverage code. We focus on our handgun weaponry. You're going to make sure and qualify with your rifle. We do lots of arrest and control tactics, reality-based training, force on force. And you also will be a basic instructor. So you'll get your peace officer license and also be a basic instructor. Is anyone here have their basic peace officer certificate? No? Well, one of the trajectories now, and I'll go over this here in a minute, but TABC is also hiring people that are non-certified CPOs and putting them through academy. So just like myself, it's an amazing opportunity. We haven't always had that. We go back and forth, and this hiring phase that's currently open, you can hire with TABC and not be a licensed peace officer right now. So what we expect from our agents, we expect them to work independently with little or no supervision. I made mention of radios earlier. You know, law enforcement is known for radios. You know, you get the calls, you're going to have to go with dispatch, DPS, local law enforcement, everyone. We don't do that. We listen to the radios. We have radio contact with our local law enforcement, but we go where we're self-governed. My agents have a list of locations that are problematic, a list of locations that the public may have complained on, and they go work that. So it's a lot of autonomy and independence that they are charged with to just go do their job. And that's not everywhere. may be required to work various shifts, including holidays, nights, weekends. We work a lot of our big drinking holidays, right? 4th of July, New Year's Eve, you're going to work at TABC. Christmas, it's not a big holiday. Maybe after, but not during. Thanksgiving, Easter, I think I've only had to ever work one non-drinking holiday in my 16 years of being employed at TABC. It doesn't come around a whole lot. So that's another benefit of working for the agency, aside from being a state worker. Adverse weather conditions, you may, but I haven't been out there in the rain or snow much. you have to attain at least a satisfactory rating on personal history, criminal history, background check, driver record, and credit card employment checks. Those are part of what we do when we do our background investigations to see if we're going to hire an employee. This is a little short video that'll kind of show you what that academy looks like. It's usually about 6 weeks after the hiring process, if you've been selected as a TABC employee. It's about a six-week academy that you go to. It's been in Austin and it's been in Bryan. I'm not sure this year's location, but this is a little video about that.
One, down, two, down, three, down, four, down, five.
One of the things that we emphasize with the cadets at TABC during this academy is that they are the new tomorrow. So they represent really the best of what Texas has to offer, and we continue to try to recruit towards that end.
They're coming from all walks of life, so our job is to bring them together as one team so they can serve our agency as an agent and serve the people of Texas.
These cadets have been in training for a five-week program where they have done some intensive work on the alcohol beverage codes, how to help people get licensed for the alcohol beverage industry, and it also helps them protect and defend and serve Texans.
Human trafficking suspect.
Not only do we teach in a classroom setting, we also put them through scenarios.
I'd really like to speak with you about what's going on.
I believe that our training is in the lead. I believe that our training goes beyond the everyday training officers receive.
So on the command of threat, I want you to unholster, maintain that good positive grip, give me one good trigger squeeze. We want to make sure that we're doing our job to protect the citizens of Texas.
This new agent is going to go out into the field telling them what the vision of TABC is, what our priorities are, and how we can make a better change in policing and the name and reputation of this great agency for tomorrow.
We want them to take home the mindset to go out there and do their job to the best of their ability, the best that they can do.
I really appreciate the effort and the work that everybody's doing.
It's a source of great pride to give Texas our best, to providing the best service for Texans, to keeping a regulated, safe alcohol industry, and to continue to bring Texas to the new tomorrow.
I may be a little biased, but I like to say this is the best gun-toting job in Texas, okay? I feel strongly about that still, again, after 16 years. The fluidity of what our job is and what the opportunity we have at TABC is just staggering. You know, you have the local, state, and federal, and it's just a great fix if you want to stay in Texas and have the mobility, too, to move around Texas. Like I said, I've been stationed in many different areas by choice, not mandatory, but by choice, as I've gone up the ladder to promote. So within TABC, I talked a little bit about the Trace Division. We also have what's called the SIU, Special Investigations Unit. Those are the ones that are heavily undercover. They have alias IDs, burner phones. They are full in that life of trying to buy the narcotics and being aware of human trafficking and assisting in that arena. So there's lots of movement besides just being an introductory agent and what you can do with that. In that Special Investigations Unit, SIU, they conduct long-term investigations. They can last for years. Money laundering. They work closely with federal, state, local law enforcement. They're many times on task forces. And one of our guys from Houston was on a task force, and he was out there with the Coast Guards and choppers and everything. It was like a Miami Vice setup because they had some guy that was smuggling alcohol in his boat. It was a whole deal. And I was like, man, that's pretty cool. You know, you don't think about that necessarily when you think TABC, right? So lots of opportunity there. And this is a little video about human trafficking. In the last couple of years, that has been an added initiative for TABC. We used to have what's called the top five public safety violations. That was the cell to minor, cell to intox, breaches, which are fights that occur, stabbing, shootings, prohibited hours, and narcotics. But in the last couple of years, we've added human trafficking. As a society, we've become so much more aware of what's going on and this just horrendous crime that's out there and occurring. So we have added that as our sixth top public safety priority. So I'll give you a little video about that.
I really lost my innocence in my childhood. When I see these, it just makes me so angry to know that one person can just destroy your life. So my name is Allison Franklin, and I am a human trafficking survivor. I was 3 years old, and my father was shot and killed. Following his death, my mother, who was 19, moved in with my great-grandparents. Little did she know that my grandfather was a predator, and shortly after my father's funeral, my grandfather began raping me. With that abuse, it just launched me on a journey of self-destruction that probably spanned over 34 years. Around 11 or 12, I started to run away from home. I found myself homeless in the streets of Houston with no food, no clothes, no place to sleep. Picked up by my first predator probably within an hour. He shared with me that I was really, really pretty and that it was dangerous out there. If I went home with him, I could stay with him until I figured things out. Over a very short period of time, he convinced me that we were in a relationship. I believed he was my boyfriend, but in fact that he had preyed upon me for his own sexual benefits and pleasures. I did escape and once again found myself homeless in the streets of Houston. At that point, I was targeted by gangs. They introduced me to drugs and became a full-fledged addict. And in that time period, I would engage in commercial sex work as well as distribution of drugs. Gang members would be ordered to kidnap me, rape me, beat me, force me to prostitute. I was groomed to purchase all his drugs, sell all his drugs. We moved money, we moved guns, we moved cars, we moved people. Including grooming me to recruit other women to be trafficked as well. I cycled in and out of our criminal justice system. I spent over 10 years collectively behind bars with 8 felonies, nearly all incurred while under the oppression of my trafficker.
So often when you're stripped of your choices from a very young kid, and then you're trafficked and your choices are stripped again, and then you come here and even more choices are stripped from you.
And it wasn't until my 9th felony that I actually got access to meaningful services that would help me exit that life.
Human trafficking is a top investigative priority, so we take it very seriously. My name is John Wall. I am a major with the Texas Alcoholic Beverage Commission Special Investigations Unit. TABC has developed and organized a unit called the Special Investigations Unit that its specialty is in focusing on human trafficking and organized crime cases that are occurring in licensed premise and alcohol beverage industry. Because we issue the permits to the licensed premise, we can go in and conduct inspections on a regular basis, and this gives us the opportunity to uncover signs of criminal activities, especially when it comes to human trafficking. If it's not for the work of our agents and our investigators, we're not going to uncover these victims to eradicate human trafficking by dismantling criminal organizations and networks. With helping victims like Allison, we can understand the mindset of what a victim has been through. If we can dive into that and understand their plight, then we can better engage the victims as we conduct these investigations and provide a better response.
Being able to access services that are meaningful was the turnaround for me. The real turnaround, though, however, was being identified as a victim of trafficking. Making that connection that I was a victim of trafficking makes me angry, but it also gives me hope that we have an opportunity to stand up and be active bystanders or just recognize our role that we all have room in this fight. I wish I didn't have the story to tell. I wish I had a different story to tell. But I hope that my story, you know, inspires others to make sure this doesn't happen to someone else.
I'm Kevin Lilly, chairman of the Texas Alcoholic Beverage Commission. It's an unfortunate fact that many victims of human trafficking are being held against their will in some of the bars, clubs, and restaurants that are licensed by the TABC. If you notice suspicious activity in a TABC-licensed bar, restaurant, or other alcohol retailer, please report it immediately. You're not only helping to save the lives of the victims, you're helping to keep an important economic engine safe for business owners and customers.
You remember anything else about this, please, if you see something that you think is suspicious, report it to TABC, report it to local law enforcement, report it to someone. This is just a deplorable act of what's being done to people. And it's, you know, we think of human trafficking, we think of like sex trafficking, but there's also the labor trafficking aspect of it. People that are being worked for 16, 17, 18 hours a day or longer, sent home, deplorable conditions, no medical care, no days off. It's just so many multifaceted to trafficking. So, you know, I think as a society, we're being more aware of this. We've learned a lot, learned a lot of the warning signs. So, again, please tell anyone you can that if they think of something suspicious, it needs to be reported. You know, when I started in law enforcement, 07, it's gone by quick. When I started in 07, it was Johns and prostitutes. Those are the terms we use for these people. And now we have such a better understanding that these people are victims. These women, these men are victims of circumstance and trafficking. And, you know, you heard her. It took her 9 felonies before she found meaningful services. I think we are moving in the right direction where we get people help faster and we identify it faster, but we always can improve. And I've loved that TABC has moved into this arena because, again, the nexus to licensed locations is so strong. I'll tell you, one of my experiences as a sergeant in Houston, My agents called me there at a cantina. It was a beer and wine license premise. It was a cantina, primarily Hispanic people there. They're there at about 3 in the morning in Houston off, I can't remember the name of the location. It's been so long. But they were off there, and they called me and they say, "Hey, Sarge, we can't get in here. We're knocking on the door. We hear music. We heard bottles cracking, but they won't let us in. Because in the state of Texas, you can't sell alcohol past 2 o'clock, okay? So it's 3 o'clock. We know that they're in there. They're drinking. Can't consume past 2:15. So I come there. We finally get inside. Okay, so we're doing an inspection. We're looking around. They go out the back, and there's a shed. And they say, "Hey, what's in the shed?" Right? It's part of the license premise, so we have the authority under the Texas Alcoholic Beverage Code to conduct an inspection in that shed. So they go to the shed. They hear more movement in the shed, more moving around. Well, we already have a violation of prohibited hours, right, and an inspection refusal because they did not let us in timely. So we have 2 violations already. Now we hear movement in the shed. We finally get access to the shed. There's like 6 or 7 males coming out and 1 young-looking female coming out. In the shed, there's trash everywhere. There's 2 mattresses on the floor. There's lots of little baggies, which can be indicative of cocaine, narcotics. And then there's some condoms used and in packages. So it doesn't take law enforcement investigator to figure out what you're looking at here, right? 7 guys in there with 1 young female. So the hardest struggle in human trafficking, though, is to get these young people, old people, anyone, you know, these people to identify themselves as victims. This young lady, she was 17, and she said, "Well, I work here. I clean up. I work in the bar, but that's all I do." And she doesn't identify herself as a victim. She won't make that outcry. It can be years of services and therapy before these people make the outcry and identify themselves as actually being victimized, right? You heard in her story, you know, she thought her first boyfriend that picked her up, he loved her. He was doing all these things to her, but it was a relationship. You know, it takes a while for them to get past that sometimes. So in this case, we have a 17-year-old. We have the 2 violations already. Now we have a 17-year-old employing 17, a minor, employing a minor at a licensed location. So we had 3 violations. We worked with the county, and we actually were able to take the license and shut them down for a year so that no one could go into business there for a year. We also connected the 17-year-old with services, but, you know, it was much like when I was a caseworker. The life they had was better than what they did have before, and they don't realize that there's more out there. So I don't know if she ever made an outcry, but we couldn't get her to say she was more than an employee working at the bar. So that's part of what TABC does. That's so much more than, like you said, just the minors and the stories that you hear. The trace, we talked about that again. Serious bodily injury, aggravated breaches. This division is available 24/7 to support local law enforcement to try to trace the alcohol, to try to identify if the bar could have possibly prevented the aggravated breach. One of the things TABC can do too is they can do what's called a summary suspension. We can shut someone down. It's a licensed premise for 7 days for a cooling off period. It's not punitive. It's looked at as, again, cooling off period, so that if we think that there's continued threat of retaliation, we just did this up in Dallas. There was a bar, the Freeman, it's in the news. There was a shooting Sunday night, Super Bowl day, and the PD believes that because of the situation around it, there's a threat for retaliation at the location. So we served our summary, and for 7 days, they're not going to be in business to operate. Again, more ways that we try to protect the community and the people. Lots of different options we have.
The TRACE program is an acronym that stands for Target Responsibility for Alcohol-Connected Emergencies. It's essentially a program designed to collaborate with local law enforcement partners and the local DA's office when there's an incident occurring that involves fatality or serious bodily injury, and there's a licensed location involved. So essentially what we try to do is source back the location of alcohol involved in that incident and determine if it was served irresponsibly.
Yeah, for us, the TRACE team, it's an invaluable partner. I think that they serve as a force multiplier.
TABC is uniquely situated to facilitate us going after these establishments and the people that put the profits over the public safety. They're out there helping us go get receipts, go get surveillance, so that we can paint a real picture for the jury as to what this individual was doing beforehand.
The program assists law enforcement agencies because they have their hands full as it is. They're handling the criminal part of the investigation. We go in there and we assist them with any video that they might need or request. A lot of times establishments are a little bit hard to get a hold of, and we have all of that information.
So our trace investigators would be deemed subject matter experts in the Alcoholic Beverage Code. Our local law enforcement partners can use our expertise to delve into the code to determine if there's a violation that occurred.
I am so fortunate as a police chief to have a great partnership with TABC in our region. It's a proven program, and I'm so glad to understand that it's moving to other parts in Texas.
To all our law enforcement partners across Texas, I would encourage you to please consider working closely with TABC's trace unit. I promise you, you will see the benefit. I know we see the benefits all the time. We want to continue that strong collaboration, and I know that law enforcement across Texas will feel the same way.
There are any number of ways that this trace program can be utilized by district attorney's offices and by local police agencies across the state.
At the end of the day, if you're doing a criminal investigation or you're doing administrative, we're just trying to bring everybody into compliance to make sure we have safer streets. And they are a big part of the success in our city and our county.
Hi, I'm Brandi Norris, Chief of Law Enforcement for the Texas Alcoholic Beverage Commission. On behalf of the TABC, I'd like to extend our appreciation to TxDOT, the state and local law enforcement agencies, and the prosecutors who are partnering with us on the TRACE program. Through this collaborative effort, we'll be able to protect the citizens and visitors to the state of Texas from these preventable tragedies.
Again, that's one more division that we have, that we offer. And my team in enforcement up in North Texas and all the other regions, they also work trace investigations, even though they're not part of the trace division, because there's only so many people in the trace division, so the workload has to be shared with everyone. We also have what's called a special response team, SRT. I have gone to 2 hurricanes so far to assist. Some people have been to about 3 or 4. That's another avenue that we have. We try to help the community in any way when things just happen. Bastrop fires, we had TABC there assisting. We also have the Honor Guard, which we started the last couple of years, which has been a great service for families of lost and fallen officers. So that's another thing TABC has. Agent qualifications, be at least 21 years of age, have a valid Texas driver's license, be certified as a Texas peace officer. That is no longer. Again, you have other options you can go down. Let me go over those a little small. If anyone is interested, I have flyers up here, and there's QR codes that you can access, and you can see what those qualifications are. But a bachelor's degree from an accredited 4-year college or university, that is one option that you can go to apply. Option 2, an associate degree with major coursework in criminal justice and 2 years military service, or 2 years full-time law enforcement. That's option 2. Option 3, to qualify, is a high school diploma or GED and 4 years full-time law enforcement experience. And option 4 is a high school diploma or GED and 4 years military service. So again, this is a rare time right now. I have postings. I brought TABC probationary agent postings for you if you'd like. You can also access them on the Texas Alcoholic Beverage Commission website under probationary agent. And you can see these 4 options for a career path with TABC that you can apply for. If you're considering the probationary agent position, you will have to complete a written exam, and you will have to pass a physical readiness test. Again, no 6-foot wall, right? So the physical readiness test consists of a Concept 2 rowing machine. You have to complete 2,000 meters within 11 minutes and 50 seconds. It's extremely reasonable. Agents must pass the PRT annually. So all of us, we complete it every year. After completing the written test and physical test, there is an interview board, and then there is a background investigation. The starting salary for TABC for a probationary agent is $49,000. But again, you're talking with benefits, holidays. It's amazing how many holidays the state of Texas has. We're about to enjoy a 3-day weekend coming up for President's Day, and we'll all be off Monday. So then, of course, after a year, you bump to an Agent 1, and that is $59,000 salary, and then it goes up every 4 years. There's also quite a bit difference if you start the supervisor trajectory and go to sergeant, lieutenant, major, and up. This fall, we are hoping that there will be a pay bump. Right now, there's a legislative session going on, and everyone is lobbying to get pay raises for Schedule C. So we hope that by the fall that will have been increased, and hopefully all state employees will have about a 10% pay increase is what we're hoping. So training and benefits. Again, we have so much training that we offer our law enforcement officers routinely. There's hazardous duty pay. There's let's see what else. Travel. We do send people to training all over. Then there's per diem that you have, hotel benefits, retirement. Lots of perks with being a TBC agent. And one more, this is going to be a video about some of the undercover training that we do.
This is a program that we've developed in order to build the capabilities and skill sets of our agents to focus specifically at human trafficking and that problem in Texas. Along with that problem comes the sale of drugs, organized crime. So it's very important that our agents are able to go in and conduct undercover operations, collect evidence, build cases. So this is a tool for the state of Texas to help keep Texans safe.
All right. So I hope that someone here has been touched by this and potentially want to make this a career. It really becomes a calling, I think, to be in law enforcement, to want to help people, and to do the job that we have. And again, to have the freedom. You know, if you work for a patrol, you can't just call in sick all the time. TABC, we have people that can fill that gap. If you need to be off, you need to be off. We really try to emphasize the whole work-life balance. That's very important to us at TABC. So that is it. I really appreciate your time. I have some chip clips pins up here, some flyers, and I will leave those as well for the criminal justice students. Does anyone have any questions? No? Okay. I really appreciate your time. Thank you.